Which artist would you associate with this music? Vermeer? Rembrandt? Constable? What about Mark Rothko? For most people, Rothko's modernist, stark canvases couldn't be further away from the quaint classicism of Mozart's music. One painted uncompromising vast psychological dramas in colour and shape, and the other wrote popularist music for the grand opera houses and concert halls of 18th century Austria. But music, and most importantly, Mozart's music, was central to Rothko's aesthetic. Rothko was obsessed with Mozart. He frequently listened to Mozart's music whilst painting and considered him the alpha and omega of composers. And through this fascination, he gave something away of how and why he approached art in the way that he did. I became a painter because I wanted to raise painting to the level of poignancy of music and poetry. So what can Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart teach us about Mark Rothko? Mozart was the archetypal child prodigy, the miracle which God let be born in Salzburg, as his father described. At a very early age, he demonstrated an astonishing musical ability. By age 6, he was performing at a professional level with his family. By age 8, he'd written his first symphony. And by the age of 11, he'd completed his first opera. This early fame propelled him into a life of inexhaustible creativity. 41 symphonies, 22 operas, 23 piano concertos, and hundreds of other smaller works. All in 35 years of life. His music is the epitome of the classical style. Clean, transparent, crisp, elegant, born out of the work of Joseph Haydn, whose music, like all who wrote in the style galant, was a railing against the density and complexity of the contrapuntal music of the Baroque. Mozart's music continued Haydn's work, prioritizing form and structure over intricacy. In particular, Mozart was a key figure in the development of sonata form. This musical structure is one that's ordinarily used for the first movement of a symphony or concerto. It's made up of three primary sections: the exposition, the development, and the recapitulation, during which the two main musical ideas are presented, developed, and revisited in various, often predetermined keys. All this is to say that Mozart's approach to music was often very formulaic, following patterns, developing ideas according to pre-designed structures, all while adopting a harmonic language and harmonic rhythm that, in some cases, feels very predictable. But to finish the summation of Mozart's music here, would be to not fully understand his music. Mozart's music may exist within the structures and forms of the classical era, but it is counterintuitively liberated by these structures. Each work has a clarity that gives every musical line a freedom to sing and to live within the music, supported by the foundations of the predetermined form. Mozart gives breath and life to each idea so that every phrase says something new within the context of the work and holds within it the possibility to express the most joyous feelings, the darkest thoughts, or the most complex of human emotions. Or, in other words, the simple expression of the complex thought. This quote is taken from a letter sent by Mark Rothko and his contemporary Adolf Gottlieb to the New York Times in 1943, in response to criticism of their art. "We favour the simple expression of the complex thought. We are for the large shape because it has an impact of the unequivocal. We wish to reassert the picture plane. We are for the flat forms because they destroy illusion and reveal truth." Although written 4 years before Rothko began painting his famous colour field works, this letter acts as a manifesto of sorts, a statement of intent, that art should serve as an expression of the human drama, an expression of truth, but that it should be done through simple means. And Rothko couldn't have chosen a simpler shape than the rectangle. Circles, triangles, any polygon would have provided a visually more stimulating form. The rectangle is benign, but it's also universal. It's the shape of screens, of pictures, of landscapes, and it's representative of the way we experience the world through our field of vision, blurred at the edges. This is how we should think of Rothko's rectangles, universal shapes juxtaposed in space, where each shape and each colour, like a note or phrase in Mozart's music, exists independently, but when combined creates something that is definitely greater than the sum of its parts. There is a horizontal direction to the movement of each shape, but there's also verticality through the way the shapes are stacked, properties that are shared with music. Music has both a horizontal axis, which is time, creating melody, but there's also verticality, which is where musical harmony comes from, through the combination of multiple notes at any point in time. The simplicity of form in Rothko's paintings also amplifies any slight change. Small variations in brushwork, in opacity, in the harshness or nebulousness of the edges, in the thickness and thinness of the paint, in the layering of colour, in the juxtaposition of the background with the shapes, and in the extent of the border. Just look at the difference between these two works, Yellow Over Purple and Untitled, both from 1956. Both use essentially the same colour scheme, but they couldn't be more different in conception and presentation. By subtly subverting the form, he forces us to ask why he's doing this. Mozart also has a similar ability to make us pay attention. Even slight changes in the structure, in the melody, in the harmony or orchestration force us to completely re-evaluate the work, its meaning and its emotional impact. Just listen to this unexpected shift to G major in the F-sharp minor movement of the 23rd piano concerto. In these tiny variations lives a world of expressivity. But what are Rothko and Mozart actually trying to express? Although Rothko never published his collected writings on art in his lifetime, he often spoke of his motivations, of what he wanted to achieve through his paintings. Rothko wanted to express something purely human in his work. What he called the tragedy of the human condition. Instead of separating his art from reality like the Impressionists, he wanted to ground it, to present unfiltered the drama of human existence. This description could just as well apply to Mozart's music, and in particular those moments of pure introspection that come in the form of his operatic arias. Time stands still at these points, and a singer, supported by the secure foundations of a simple structure, explores the most complex of human emotions through melody. Rothko often said that Mozart was smiling through tears. Mozart and Rothko are so often both pushed into the background. Rothko's paintings are resigned to a decorative status, and Mozart's music has almost become a cliché through its use in the background of film and television. But by both looking closely and listening carefully, you can begin to understand their art. Both artists' work might be considered formulaic, but the formula, the structure, provides the foundation for the greatest of expression. To understand their art is to understand what it means to be human. But this can only be experienced when you give something of yourself, when you approach it with an openness and a vulnerability. To really hear a piece of Mozart, or to really see a Rothko painting, is to see yourself. Hi everyone, thank you for watching. A lot of the inspiration for this essay came from Christopher Rothko's book on his father, Mark Rothko, From the Inside Out, It's a fascinating read, and I thoroughly recommend you buy it if you want to find out more about Rothko's paintings. I put a link to it in the description below. This is also my fourth video on the relationship between music and art, so if you like this one, then do take a look at some of the other similar videos linked here. See you next time.